Cantor Arts Center at Stanford University.
Hello, everybody. It's a pleasure to welcome you to the Cantor Arts Center for the keynote lecture introducing our exhibition, Rodin in America, which opened today and which will remain on view through January 1st. It is my great honor tonight to introduce Antoinette Lenormand Romain, one of the world's foremost Rodin scholars. After completing her studies at the École du Louvre, Ms. Lenormand Romain was appointed founding curator of sculpture at the Musée d'Orsay, where, among other things, she collaborated in cataloging its massive sculpture collection. In 1994, she became head of sculpture at the Musée Rodin, where she organized numerous exhibitions, co-authored a study on Rodin's watercolors, and finally published the immense and immensely thorough two-volume catalog of the museum's bronzes. Then in 2006, she became head of the National Institute for Art History, a new research library that has the ulterior purpose of encouraging scholarly collaboration. In addition to her work on Rodin, Antoinette has published on 19th century French funerary art and on other sculptors, notably Jules Dallou and Antoine Bourdelle. She is presently working on a monograph on Rodin, and tonight she will speak on Rodin's American admirers. Please join me in welcoming Antoinette Lenormand Romain.
Thank you, Bernard, for these kind words. For me, it's a great pleasure to be here tonight. So can we have the dark? Yes. In 1954, the sculptor Jacques Lipschitz could assert, Rodin is still an unknown man. And Leo Steinberg confirmed 20 years later, I quote, its spiritless debilitation well into the 1960s seemed to confirm Musée Rodin obsolescence while modern art burgeoned around the world. Until 1955, New York Museum of Modern Art possessed not one of Rodin's sculptures. To see Rodin during those years, New Yorkers would have gone up to the Metropolitan Museum. But there, during the 1930s and 40s and 50s, it was the glossy marble copies that were on display, serving as decorative centerpieces in the painting galleries. The museum's great Rodin bronzes were in storage until 1957. And the unique, astonishing small plaster and terracotta fragments, which the museum had received as a gift from Rodin himself, these have not been in view again since they arrived in 1913. To tell the truth, in the 1930s and 40s, Rodin, who died in 1917, had to get across a period of neglect, even though he had been highly praised by American people during his lifetime. Rodin's first personal contact with the States occurred through Truman Bartlett, a sculptor and journalist who spent hours in Rodin's studios in 1887 and wrote, consequently, the first important study about him, which was published in the American Architect and Building News in 1889. These 10 papers give us a lot of information about the first part of the artist's career, the time when he was working on the gates of hell. At that moment, he was getting known, but nevertheless, his studio was plain, almost poor, as we discover through an unpublished description of his studio preserved in Bartlett's archives, which is a perfect commentary of these photographs. So I quote Bartlett, on the walls were a dead, dried cat presenting an aspect weird and alchemistic. Another dried little dog, a copy of St. Gaudens Medallion of Le Page. An oil portrait of Le Page, which you can see. Which you can see here. An oil portrait of Le Page by himself, head and shoulders, palette and brushes in hand, nearly full face. A looking glass about 2 feet square. A large armchair doré. Two small common chairs. Bust of Dalou Inoue, St. John the Baptist, here. Broken nose, Rochefort. Shelves without number. Little old desk covered with papers, letters, a dried mucilage bottle, remains of teapot, several modeling stands, large ladders and platforms for working in port. Floor covered with plaster figures and groups belonging to Dor, group of Paul and Frances of Rimini. 13 years later, in 1900, the year of Rodin's great success with his personal show in Paris, the studio was not very different. When he called on him, Lorado Taft had imagined he would be, I quote, ushered into a reception room with waxed floors and tapestries Louis XV and little masterpieces fresh from the great artist's hand, perched all about on gilded pedestals. But to his surprise, he found himself in a very quiet courtyard with a row of, I quote, ordinary, somewhat neglected looking studios, great sheds with front of glass. There, Rodin had a studio like anybody else, where there was absolutely no attempt at display. It was a workshop and nothing else. But for this reason, it was infinitely more fascinating than any museum. At that date, 1900, there were very few works by Rodin in American museums. But this was to change soon, as testified by 3 important collections, New York, San Francisco, and Washington. The San Francisco and Washington collections were donated as complete collections by private individuals. The origin of the Metropolitan Museum of Art collection is completely different. It was built with the help of many different people, and consequently, it clearly indicates to what extent the taste for Rodin's work was developing in North America. The Met was given the bust of St. John the Baptist in 1893 by Samuel P. Avery. And it was the first piece of a collection which is today one of the most important in quality, if not in number. The bust, as I'm sure you know, is a part of the St. John the Baptist, larger than life size, a statue which had been modeled and exhibited in 1880. At that time, Rodin, a great admirer of Donatello, competed with Florentine sculptors in the chiseling of surface. The savage aspect of St. John surprised French people when it was exhibited at the Paris Salon. But at least, the bust could not be accused of eroticism, as was the case of the sculptures sent by Rodin to the Columbian Exhibition in Chicago in the same year, 1893, the year when the bust entered the Metropolitan Museum. It is well known that the Rodin sculptures in Chicago were closed in a cabinet and visitors had to ask to be allowed to see them. They were considered much too sensual and full of passion. And indeed, Rodin was a great admirer of nature, and he let the bodies speak their own language in the search of expression, as we can see in this group showing 2 young lovers completely naked, clasping in one another's arms, entangling their legs in a way which symbolizes passion. This group was carved in 1891 by Jean Escula, one of Rodin's best assistants, but its success came late, only after 1900. In the beginning of the 20th century, two other copies were carved, one of them having been donated to the Metropolitan Museum in 1938. In the 1890s, Rodin's reputation rested on these kinds of groups. French collectors were keen to get them, and Rodin had to manage a large workshop. As it is the case today with sculptors as, for instance, Anthony Caro, Gormley, and others, he had to supply as fast as possible the many marbles people raved to acquire. He had modeled plenty of figures for the Gates of Hell in the beginning of the 80s. And he had now what can be seen as a stock. He could pick up some little figures and stick them together, adding an arm or anything else. And in that way, he was able to create new groups very quickly. Normally, the work of sculpture takes time if you have to go through all the steps, modeling of the clay, baking, molding, carving, and so on. The Cupid and Psyche, ordered by Yerkes in 1893, is a good example of this way of carving. It is made of two already existing figures. In Psyche, you can recognize the small Faunus, which Rodin was very fond of and reused many times. And in Cupid, I think that you can recognize one of the two geniuses of the Benedictines, but I am not perfectly sure of that. Rodin was driven only by the power of form, never by a subject, and as long as they remained in plaster, these groups had no title. But when he decided to have them translated into marble and exhibit them, he needed to identify them clearly, which means to imagine a subject. And at that point, he turned to mythology or allegory. For instance, there is no real difference between the evil spirits, which you can see here in the show, and a famous assemblage, two Eve and the crouching women. Except that the first one was translated into marble and sold to a collector, Mrs. Simpson, when the other one never left the studio. Nobody saw it nor spoke of it, and today we are unable to date it and explain what Rodin had in mind. We can only make technical observations. It is made of two plaster casts of Eve, one more refined than the other, a cast of the crouching woman, a dry branch of a tree here, and some freshly modeled plaster pieces. And it was given a title, which is a description, not a subject, as is the evil spirits. American collectors were late in comparison with French ones. The French state had bought the terrible old courtesan and the beautiful Danaïde for the Musée du Luxembourg in Paris in 1890 and 1891. In 1894, when a man as Charles T. Yerkes acquired the two beautiful marbles today in the Metropolitan Museum of Art, Cupid and Psyche, and Orpheus, Rodin stated that they were to be his first original works in an American collection. Indeed, it is after 1900 that the main collections were built, and first of all, Mrs. Simpson's. Having ordered her portrait to Rodin, she became one of his strongest admirers and supporters, assembling many sculptures and drawings and encouraging acquisitions by American museums. Eventually, she donated her collection to the National Gallery of Art in Washington. As soon as 1903, she had acquired five sculptures, among which The Thinker and The Walking Man, both in their original size and cast by Alexis Rudier. They are among the first casts Rudier made for Rodin, and he gave them beautiful blue-green patinas. When they arrived in December 1903, they were also the first copies of the sculptures in North America, but soon to be followed, in the case of The Thinker, by another cast bought by the dancer Loy Fuller, who admired Rodin and acted as his agent. And the bronze today in the Yale Art Gallery had been dedicated to her in 1906. Kate Simpson and Loy Fuller's Thinkers were in the original size of the gates, 71 centimeters. But soon after 1900, Rodin decided to enlarge the sculpture, and the plaster exhibited in Paris in 1904 was much bigger than the 1882 one. It was much admired. I quote, "Your friend Pompon was tremendously enthusiastic about it," Le Bossé informed Rodin. And he went on, "He should let you know himself, having found that far from losing anything in the enlargement, your sculpture has gained a grandiose and vital quality while scrupulously retaining your special touch." Indeed, the enlargement highlights the quality of the modeling, particularly on the back, with the very detailed depiction of the musculature. In addition, the colossal proportion confer a force upon the allegory, heightened by the extreme simplicity of the work, devoid of all accessory. The Thinker contrasted with other, much more descriptive, contemporary sculptures, and it assumed a universal character through its timeless nudity. As you know, in the beginning it was the portrait of Dante, but in 1904, people saw in it, I quote, "the ordinary workman, anonymous, unknown, the first of the proletarians, whose natural coarseness the artist has exaggerated." But it was in the attitude of a scholar. In a climate of political and social unrest, it was perceived as an homage to the people and a symbol of democracy and egalitarian society. Its huge fame really began at that time. The first cast of The Big Thinker was done at the same moment for the Louisiana Purchase International Exposition in St. Louis. Rodin had turned to the founder Ebrard, who was one of the renewers of the Lost Works process. Ebrard was very proud of the commission because he was aware of the publicity that it would mean for him. And after a series of negotiations, he agreed to cast The Thinker for 10,000 francs, which was a very low price. Christmas, The Thinker is cast. And as far as one can tell, it has been successful. He could announce to Rodin at the end of the year. And a few days later, he estimated that the chasing would take another week before the bronze could be patinated. But the ship on which the works for the St. Louis exposition had to sail was due to leave Le Havre on the 13th of January. Ebrard did what had to be done for his cast to be ready for patina in time. And he was extremely pleased with it. The Thinker, he said, looked as if it had been modeled directly in bronze. But when Rodin saw it, the chasing was not quite what he had expected. He therefore announced that he would not be sending it to St. Louis, to the great displeasure of André Saglio, the curator of the French exhibition, who wrote to him, "I cannot believe that after such a long wait, so much inconvenience, and so much conniving for the exhibition of sculpture in St. Louis, where your thinker was to be my centerpiece, my keystone, you are purely and simply withdrawing your work because of your few details in the chasing. I make no secret of the fact that I am absolutely devastated, as is Ebrard, who, in addition, is quite sick." Rodin eventually agreed to let the bronze go to St. Louis, but then, in March, he decided to send a plaster. Therefore, the bronze was not shown, which did not prevent it from finding a buyer in the United States for the nice sum of 25,000 francs. And the bronze ended in Louisville in 1949. As for the plaster, not wanting to trouble with its return to France, the French Ministry of Public Instruction and Fine Arts gave it to the Metropolitan Museum in 1905. During that time, Kate Simpson had pointed out that the Met sculpture collection was noticeably deficient, and she urged the trustees to do something. She wrote, "Rodin is now an old man, and the time is limited in which it will be possible to command his services. But I know from having visited his studios, both that in Paris and that in Meudon, that he has now on hand some beautiful finished and unfinished work which could probably be obtained." She began by lending two bronzes, and she ordered a new cast of the Age of Bronze, which was installed in the place of honor at the foot of the Metropolitan Museum Great Staircase in 1906. Rodin thanked her with beautiful words, "I often think of you, who by your goodness has meant so much in my life. There is no word for women who encourage those in arts, men we call the mécènes. You know how much I love your family, so noble, so affectionate. And after the admiration you have shown for my works, I need to be a friend whose friendship will bring us even closer together." The Age of Bronze was Kate Simpson's unique gift to the Metropolitan Museum, but her influence was instrumental. For instance, her sister, following her example, had bought a small walking man, which is inscribed with this dedication: "Monsieur Rodin, happy to see his work in her salon, presents his affectionate respects to her." And later, she donated the bronze to the museum. But moreover, Kate Simpson had a strong influence on Edward Robinson, vice director of the museum in these years when the major Rodin acquisitions were achieved. She was helped by Daniel Chester French, a sculptor, but also on the board of trustees and chairman of the Committee of Sculpture from 1903. In 1906, the committee urged that the museum acquire works by modern sculptors, American as well as European, asserting that it would be possible to create a collection of popular interest for, I quote, "the cost of one work of antiquity, of historic or archaeological value." And the committee recommended to purchase works by Barry, Rodin, and St. Gaudens. Consequently, two sculptures by Rodin were ordered. The third one, The Hand of God, was given by Edward D. Adams, member of the committee, and another one, A Muse, promised by Samuel P. Colt, but never given since Rodin was late in delivering it. Perhaps because of Ryan's example, Ryan of whom we are going to speak in a few minutes, Colt decided he would rather create a Rodin collection in Massachusetts. He had profited by the fear the declaration of the year of war had inspired Rodin to buy four other marble sculptures. But he himself died a few years later and the sculptures were put in an auction. It is a pity, since they would have demonstrated Rodin's approach to marble in the last years of his career, and in particular, the way in which the figure seems to spring up from the marble block, the block itself being just sketched out. In New York, at that point, the want of funds would have prevented the Met to go on and develop its collection if Thomas Fortune Ryan had not come on stage. Ryan is said to have been introduced to Rodin by the American-born Duchess of Choiseul. Her influence on the artist is considered to have been disastrous, but nonetheless, she seems to have been instrumental in providing Rodin with American clients. In 1909, Rodin made Ryan's bust, and the sitter developed a deep admiration for the artist, and the following year, he gave the Metropolitan Museum the two marbles of the York's collection, and a third, Pygmalion and Galatea, purchased from Rodin. And he provided an additional $25,000 for further purchase, leaving the choice to the museum. The choice consisted of bronzes. Adam, Eve, the old courtesan, of marbles, the Tempest, which is here, beside the sea, of terracottas, of drawings, these wonderful free drawings enhanced with watercolor, which helped us to enter into the artist's fancy world. Rodin had a personal drawing show in New York in 1903, and most of the drawings today in the Met collection arrived in the States at that occasion. And to show the museum his gratitude, Rodin added small plaster and terracotta sketches, which give the collection its very special character, a thing which he did not do, or only for close friends, as Mrs. Simpson or Lloyd Fuller, since the sketches were a most private work, as can be only found in the storage of the Musée Rodin. The trustee's choice was interesting since some of the bronzes had never been cast before. The Met got the first cast of Adam, a figure which had been modeled and exhibited in 1881 to be put with Eve on each side of the gates, as it is the case here in Stanford. Michelangelo's influence is obvious in both figures of Adam and Eve, but particularly in Adam, which twisting torso and hanging arm remind us of the dead Christ in the Firenze Duomo Pietà. Another sculpture of which the Met owns the first cast is The Martyr, donated in 1913 thanks to Kate Simpson, who convinced Watson Dickerman to commission it, and we know that Rodin was very happy of this commission. It is again a figure modeled for the gates and later enlarged, one of these figures which demonstrates Rodin's link with a very long tradition. head falling backward and left arm stretching apart. It follows the conventions in use since antiquity to portray those who sleep or those who died a violent death. But it is also a figure which appears many times in Rodin's work, where it should probably be seen as an allusion to Baudelaire's poem, A Martyr, describing in a confusion of horror and eroticism, a woman beheaded by her lover. In Baudelaire's words, on the bed, the new torso shamelessly displays, with the most complete abandon, the secret splendor and fatal beauty that nature had bestowed on her. We recognize the figure in the drawings Rodin made for Baudelaire's Flowers of Evil, but also in the Yerkes Orpheus, which present the same square angle between arm and shoulder, or later in a tympanum in a villa built on La Clément Said. The Rodin galleries at the Metropolitan Museum of Art opened in 1912. I am proud to be called Rodin's pupil, Malvina Hoffman said then. And 2 months later, she wrote to the master, I often go to the Rodin galleries studying the marbles, your portrait by Mac Cameron, presented by J.P. Morgan. But for me, it lacks the strength, the fire of your genius, which is always burning in your eyes when they are opened as in the portrait. However, it's you. When the First World War burst out, the Metropolitan Museum had no rival. Of course, New York City cannot make itself proud of having ordered, as Buenos Aires, a public monument in memory of one of its great men, as is the monument to President Sarmiento, inaugurated in 1900, or a cast of the large sinker to be installed in front of the Parliament Palace. But private collectors had followed Kate Simpson's example. People like Alexander Harrison, Major Higginson, Eugene Enigmismayer, Isaac Fletcher had acquired sculptures, these glossy marbles which Steinberg scorned without taking in consideration how important they were to Rodin's eyes. These people were proud to have been able to secure them, and later they presented the marbles to the Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Arts, the Boston Museum of Fine Arts, as the CERES, the Washington National Gallery of Art, or the Metropolitan Museum of Art. At that date, the New York collection gave a very good view of Rodin's work. Besides some of his most famous sculptures, and apart from the sketches, the visitors could see Eve, given again by Thomas Fortune Ryan. Eve had been begun by 1881-82, but it was left aside when Rodin discovered that the sitter was pregnant. And it was not until 1899 that he decided to exhibit the sculpture. Occupying a privileged position in the middle of the rotunda of the exposition building in Paris, the bronze was placed on the ground in order to make the visitor close to the piece so as to create an effect of proximity. The plaster had not been reworked, and the figure still included barely finished areas, which left the otherwise admiring public somewhat perplexed. And you can see here in the ankles the piece of iron which helped the figure to stand. A reviewer said that Monsieur Rodin's Eve is one of the most magnificently invented statues that I know. One cannot imagine a more expressive and powerful silhouette. The inner construction has a force that no other sculptor in this day and age has mastered to such a degree. But, he concluded, Monsieur Rodin, having thoroughly constructed his figure, did not think he needed to linger over the surface, left unpolished and uneven. In 1882, Rodin competed with Renaissance sculptors and he wanted to get a perfect and quivering surface. If he was not able to achieve it, he had rather not to go on. But what looked unfinished in 1882 fit perfectly well with his idea of sculpture in 1899, a sculpture more free, in which non finito means that the form had been reproduced at a step of its evolution, but still can change. And indeed, having been judged unacceptable in 1882 and perfect in 1899, Eve shows how deeply Rodin had changed. It is fascinating for us to be able to observe that so clearly in only one sculpture. Indeed, Rodin's art had taken a new direction. If we go back to those years, 1893-95, when the first marbles arrived in North America, they were a difficult time for him. Camille Claudel had just left him. He had a lot of troubles with the Balzac monument, and he was going through a kind of breakdown. He was unable to go ahead and create something really new. He could only assemble figures which were already existing to obtain new groups. But these years helped him to think about sculpture and after a while, to commit himself into a new approach, the partial figure. 1895-97 are the years in which Iris, the Earth, the Meditation, and the Tragic Muse were achieved, exhibited, cast, and sold almost only to Germans, more open-minded at that time. It was difficult for the Americans, as for the French people, to put up with these bold and innovative sculptures. And except Mrs. Simpson's small walking man, then thought to be a study for St. John the Baptist, none of the partial figures entered the American collections at that time. Until much later, indeed, until the Rodin Rediscovered show, in 1981, Rodin was imprisoned in an image which was the same since the 1915 Panama Pacific exhibition in San Francisco or the Rodin Museum in Philadelphia, which opened in 1929. When this museum opened, a copy of the keys was thought necessary. And a fourth copy was then carved by the sculptor Henri Greber. However, it had been a long time since Rodin had lost his interest in what we can call expressive sculpture. In the 1890s, until he needed a counterpart of the Balzac, which he knew would stir a scandal, he had left aside the big marble keys, which he considered to be not much more than a bibelot. And when he exhibited the two of them in 1898, Balzac was rejected when the keys was so much praised that two other marble copies were immediately ordered. Enriched in the movies industry and a great admirer of Rodin, Jules Masbaum had succeeded in convincing Georges Grappe, the curator of the Paris Museum, to sell him the bronzes which had been commissioned by Kojiro Matsukata, a Japanese patron. Among these bronzes were the gates of hell. Having worked a lot at the gates during the 1880s, Rodin undid them in 1900 and only exhibited the background, all the figures having been taken away. But Benedict, who was the first curator of the Rodin Museum in Paris, aware of their importance as a departure point of Rodin's work, had them restored before Rodin's death, and then he looked for a sponsor to commission a cast. Matsukata was the man, but because of high taxes, he couldn't have the bronzes sent to Japan. Consequently, they were put in storage in Paris, and they were, if necessary, available for somebody else. And that allowed Masbaum to get the first cast of the gates. Masbaum wanted his museum to be as similar as possible to the French one, not the Paris Museum, however, but the place in Meudon, a small town close to Paris, where Rodin had lived and where a large pavilion full of light sheltered the plaster casts. The Meudon facade was the facade of a neighboring castle destroyed a few years earlier and bought by Rodin, and it was copied in Philadelphia with the large sinker head of it, as in Meudon, where it stands on Rodin's tomb. And even if the French Museum finally gave some plasters, exactly as Rodin did in 1912 to the Metropolitan Museum of Art, 90% of the collection are bronzes. Masbaum wanted to have all the famous sculptures, Age of Bronze, Eve, Burgers of Calais, and, as we have seen, even A Marble Kiss. Therefore, the Philadelphia Museum is more interesting as an image of Rodin as he was understood at that date than as a genius of sculpture, always able to invent new approaches. Yes, for sure, Masbaum had ordered the first bronze of the gates, 30 years after Rodin had stopped to work on them, but he never made up his mind on, for instance, Balzac, or moreover, the Working Man. To have this new image of Rodin, it was necessary to wait until after the Second World War. Cecil Goldscheider, then curator of the Rodin Museum in Paris, succeeded in convincing people to turn to Rodin's last sculptures, some of which had never been cast. Taste had changed, and in 1954, when Kurt Valentin, the famous art dealer, died, his friends gave the Museum of Modern Art in New York a bronze cast of the Balzac, which, after the renovation of the museum a few years ago, was the first work of art the visitors saw when they entered the building. Kurt Valentin had been the one in charge of trading the large iris closed in the basement of the Boston Museum of Fine Arts and labeled unexhibitable until 1953, when it was deaccessioned. This iris was one of the 8 bronzes cast before 1907, and all in private hands until after the Second World War, except the Musée Rodin Musée Rodin I. And even if it obviously inspired Marcel Duchamp, étant donné, American admirers of Rodin had to wait until the 1960s to be able to see the sculpture in the Washington Hirshhorn Museum. As for the Working Man, the first six bronzes stayed in Europe, but after 1962, eight out of the nine bronzes which were still cast went to the States and are today in Washington, Houston, Pasadena, Edwardsville, Northampton, Los Angeles, Wellesley, and the last one here in Stanford. In Stanford, you can also find the large Cybele and the inner voice or meditation. As the working man, these two figures were very important to Rodin. He had them cast in bronze and exhibited in London in 1914. After the war was declared, worrying for his sculptures, he decided to give England the ones which were already in London. Consequently, they were lacking the collection he donated to the French state, and the Musée Rodin had to wait until 1980 to get new bronze casts at exactly the same time they were done for Stanford. Thanks to Bernie Cantor, cleverly advised by Albert Elson, the Stanford collection shows the traditional Rodin, the Rodin of the Gates, influenced by Michelangelo and looking for expression more than anything else, but also a more modern Rodin, the Rodin who looked at antiquity and thought that to be perfect and beautiful, a figure needed not to be complete. Thank you very much for your attention. Yes, sure.
On some of Rodin's bronzes, you can see the marks of the mold.
Yes, sir.
Why did he leave those out? Why was that removed and chiseled?
Because Rodin liked the marks of his work be visible. He thought, you know, that the process of sculpture was a part of the sculpture itself, and it's a part of this transformation of sculpture at that time. Rodin was no longer interested in subjects as St. John the Baptist, for instance, but in sculpture, in form, and he wanted the forms, the volume, speak by themselves and speak of sculpture and of the way of the material was approached, you know, all these different steps of the work. And it was, yes, you are perfectly right, it was important for him to have the marks. And here you have a beautiful example with the meditation without arms, on which you can see the seam lines and also a plot of perhaps plaster, which has remained on the belly of the figure. But characteristic of Rodin sculptures. Another, no. No more.